Hi, I'm Russell and I love brains.
Hi, I'm Angela and I love microbes.
I'm Spiros. I love whiskey. And I know that this glass does not exist.
Why exactly are you qualified to be here on a drinking show?
I'm qualified because I know things about the brain. I'm a cognitive neuroscientist.
So you really know how bad alcohol is for all of us.
The better it is, the worse, right? You know, kind of thing. Why?
Why am I?
Do you feel you are the best of the three of us at making this?
I'm certainly not the best at making it, but
that's
I will say that without microbes, we would not have alcohol to begin with.
Oh.
I study plants and bacteria and the symbiosis between them.
Okay.
I've gotten a taste of you explaining the universe, and I'm excited to hear more about that as we move forward.
Which is why I am an expert in making cocktails.
Really?
That's right. Because, you know, if you put a little bit of this and a little bit of that, like, then the Big Bang does the rest of the work for you. So I'm hoping that, you know, it will come back to me. And I do believe that when life gives you lemons, you ask for a bartender to tell you what to do with them, right?
Hi.
Hi.
It's so nice of you guys to lay all this out and surprise me knew what to do.
You're welcome.
So you were told that you were going to mess around with elements of heat today.
Yeah.
Well, you know, we took that, it's an interpretation of that, and I'm going to teach you guys how to make a whiskey sour, a classic sour, sometimes called a Boston sour, because it contains egg whites, just the whites, and I'm throwing in a little curveball, and we're using serrano peppers. First thing I'll do is, you want to do about an ounce of lemon juice. It's about a full lemon. So now that I've kind of wet the bottom of the tin, I'm gonna throw in the serrano pepper now. So I'll do that. And you don't wanna kill it, you just wanna give it a push, kind of just release the flavors. Next step is you wanna do the sweet component. So most cocktails have a citrus, then you wanna do a sweet. And here I have a house-made simple syrup. So I'm gonna do about 3/4 of an ounce of simple syrup. So slightly less than the citrus. So the next step is your egg white. And so what you do here is you do a little crack. Make sure you don't get the yolk into the tin. And then, of course, the main event, your booze. And you want to do 2 full ounces. So you always get like 2 parts whiskey and 1 part everything else, in a sense. So let me get the ice. So I'm just gonna fill up my tin, and keep it close.
So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna strain it out. Do one fine strain, get all the seeds out. Then I will dump the ice, and then we'll do the dry shake.
All right. Into your coupe glass.
Look at this.
The last element of the cocktail that you actually get on the palate is a little bit of Angostura bitters. I'll do a little design.
It's all about presentation. Give it a little zest of the lemon. Mm-hmm. Just kind of like, look at that.
That's beautiful.
Look at that.
Wow.
So here,
oh my goodness.
We have our serrano pepper.
It's beautiful.
Whiskey sour. It's gonna be pretty hot, nice and tart.
Ooh. That is so good.
Okay.
I have to imagine that something is happening to the egg whites when you're shaking it specifically with the lemon juice, that it's like denaturing it.
Oh, interesting. Like, what is denaturing?
Basically messing up all of the proteins, like,
okay.
Because it's interacting with the acid, but I don't actually know.
What's interesting too though is that there's a whole debate on the order of operations when you're doing whiskey sour. So there are bartenders that will exclusively dry shake first, which is before adding the ice, they'll do a full shake and then get the foam. But then my thought process is then you're diluting more after the fact, and I feel like doing the shake later is better.
So in mathematical lingo, if you cannot actually change the order of operations,
mm-hmm.
right? Because usually when you multiply the numbers, it doesn't matter which way you do it,
ah.
You know? But there are situations where if you change the order of operations, you get something very different at the end. Even though you have exactly the same ingredients that you're putting there. And that actually turns out to be the very foundation of quantum physics. Mm. Right? They tell you that if you do something out of order, you literally just change the outcome. You know, that's the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, where you weren't supposed to look like, you know, and then if you look, you kill the cat. It's kind of like that, right? You know, open before like the release of the poison and all that stuff. But it turns out that, I guess the universe works a little bit like a cocktail. All right.
Thanks.
So I guess we got to get into this, right? I don't remember anything, but I'm still doing stuff anyways.
I was wondering why, like, psychologically people like to eat spicy food, because that seems like something that's a little bit counterintuitive. Like, why would you want to eat something that's causing you pain?
Oh, yeah. So one of the popular theories of, like, why... I'm going to go do my egg while I'm dealing with this.
Yeah.
The idea is this idea of benign masochism. It's kind of in general that like people safely try dangerous things. The feeling that you have when you're tasting something spicy is the same thing happening when you're burnt. Oh my God, are you okay?
Ooh,
you got it.
I got it. Yeah.
So if the same sensation that you feel when something is spicy is the same sensation when you're getting burned.
Oh.
Literally when you're getting burned.
Well, it makes sense. Because like the spiciness in it, like it causes inflammation, and like that's why we perceive it to be hot, right? Like these peppers aren't literally like temperature hot.
Yeah, it's just activating the receptors that are hot, that perceive hot.
It's just spicy. It's different, right? It's
well,
not like, you know,
it's
heat.
Both.
Heat is... Is it though? Because heat requires like the average kinetic energy of molecules being real high, right? It's a thermodynamic quantity, doesn't actually exist. But heat itself is a made-up quantity, right? It's not like the spin of an electron, right? Or the charge of like a proton. It's something that only exists in an emergent fashion, right? You need to have a lot of things together bouncing around each other. And then all of a sudden, you know, they kick each other, right? And they start increasing the energy, which is called the kinetic energy, which is, if you remember, mass times velocity squared, divided by two. So when you have a lot of this together and they're jiggling very hard, we call that something with high temperature. Because if you think of heat as an element like of reality, it's not there. It's made up, right? You look anywhere, like, you know, a small number of particles, they don't have heat because there's like very few. There's no averaging happening. How do they do it? Nice.
Ooh, that's a good slap.
Learning.
Frozen.
I'm gonna use this. Thank you. Go a few more over my side. This is actually
yeah. Just grab. I wasn't done, but
ready.
Three.
Set.
Two.
Shake.
Oh, this is cold.
Okay. So, I am so cold right now.
Yeah, but he doesn't exist, so you're fine.
I'm about to pour my drink, y'all. I did a dry shake at the end, by the way.
Organisms on this planet are microbes. They're called hyperthermophiles, and these are organisms, they're usually either archaea or bacteria, hyperthermophiles, are able to survive and thrive at 80 degrees Celsius or higher, which for us imperialist normies is about 180 degrees Fahrenheit.
So. Imperialist normies. That is true.
Yeah.
Yes, wonderful.
So, but 180 degrees Fahrenheit or higher, that's insane. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't even imagine. And some of them can even survive at, like, I think the upper limit right now is 220 degrees Fahrenheit, is, like, the temperature that some of these cells prefer to live. which is really, really insane and crazy. So our cell membranes are made up of lipids, fats. So they're fluid. It's a fluid membrane, and that's a good thing. And it's perfect for the range of temperatures that we like to live in. But for them, if they have the exact same type of membrane, thinking about fats, like what happens when you put butter in a microwave?
It
like,
melts beautifully and it smells amazing.
True, but it falls apart, right?
Yes.
So you can imagine like what would happen if we have these fluid cell membranes that are going into super hot environments. They're suddenly not as structured and they can't hold the cell anymore. So what they do is they have special structures and different kinds of bonds that just give their cell membrane a little bit more structure so that when it's hitting those high temperatures, they're not gonna like completely melt apart. What we want to find from them is that if they are thriving at these super high temperatures, they have proteins that can also live at those super high temperatures without getting denatured like these egg whites. So as scientists, we're always looking for new proteins, new enzymes that can withstand the crazy stuff that we want to do.
So what I wanted to share about heat was specifically about tasting spicy things and how we taste spicy things. So how I'm going to demonstrate this is I got some wasabi. So take a look, we're going to do before and after to kind of explain it. That's a lot. That's good. Wasabi and horseradish and certain kinds of peppers have a lot of volatile chemicals, which are chemicals that basically are in the air and you smell them. And so what you're going to do is this time when you eat it, you're going to close your nose. And then now release your nose halfway through.
This is amazing. Usually I would be crying right now.
I felt like I was tasting it more on my tongue, and then when I released my nose, it was like shooting it out of my nose. I don't know.
The volatile chemicals come up through into your sinuses. So when you close your nose, that you don't actually experience that. When you release it, that was what the rush that you felt was the volatile chemicals going through the retronasal pathway.
That's cool.
I love the danger that comes with science, you know? This extreme feeling of like, you don't know what's gonna happen. Cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you.
To heat.